Good afternoon, everybody. I hope you all enjoyed lunch wherever you are. I just had my sandwiches behind the screen. So I want to continue our discussion, and now we're looking on the role of port cities and creativity. And I call this part of the lecture Looking for the Soft City. You all are aware of the long-term developments, which is, I think, a part of your global orientation. If you look, for instance, at the longer duration in history, for instance, using the Kondratiev cycles as a way of orientation. And then you notice all these different categories of you could say leading sectors in the economy and in economic history. It started with the steam engine got in, railways, electric engineering, chemistry, resulting in the second industrial revolution, the age of the automobile and the oil industry, and then in the post-war era, we have another shift. And the shift is now in a post-industrial setting. And there are a lot of uncertainties about this post-industrial setting. What will be the development in the future? What will be the Kondratiev for the coming 50, 60 years? And a lot of us think that because of the internet, is the age of the internet? Is it the age of the artificial intelligence? It's the age of the health, very actual at this very on this moment, and we all are looking for futures beyond 2020. What will be the role? And in particular, when we're dealing with creativity, we have to face the questions: okay, what does this mean? Creativity, the challenges in a post-industrial setting, when the added value is not in the hardware, not in the steel, the railway, etc., but in a softer engineered added value, what will that bring? And this is the reason why the creativity and creative economy has become such a hallmark of future developments. And if you look at the creative economy, and this is the Routledge Companion to Cultural Industries. And the editors come up with, you could say, three major trends. And these trends are familiar to you, I'm sure of that. But one of the great strengths of education is repeating what you already know. So this is probably not new for you. But I think for our discussion, because we have to face the question, what does this all mean for the major challenges for port cities? So to summarize the major trends, we all are aware of the digital revolution, new concepts out of co-makership. The fact that I'm now addressing you not face to face, but via a digital encounter already is an example of a digital way, how digital devices actually re-establish and has to do with reinventing our role as teachers. But the other thing is that co-makership. So that means, what does it mean for the education? You are all co-makers in itself. And of course, the creative class Richard Florida. You will hear enough about him, so I'm not going to deal with him in major detail, but he still is important because of his creation of this narrative of creativity within this global setting. And I'll come back to that later. And I think this is something which we have to be aware of. When Richard Florida started addressing the creative industries, it was more or less focused on derelict areas, in fringe areas, marginal areas, for instance, port cities, on the waterfront, areas which were unused, which were available for all kind of cultural production, squatting areas, but also production areas of art. But if we're looking at the investments in creative industries, well, we must be aware we're now dealing with advanced creative industries. And this is what you see, for instance, in the creative industry in Asia. They are, as became clear from the report of McKinsey on globalization, that there is now a major role for these industries in the advanced creative industries. So that means that creativity, culture, and technological development, they all come together now and bringing in a new way of looking at future economic developments. And another, you could say, star making is Charles Landry, because he said, well, the urban engineering is dead. He looks particularly at the art of city making, and his popular book on the art of city making really focuses on that you need creativity as a new way of urban planning. So where urban planning is perhaps more related to a creative way of looking at how are you going to sell your city, which is part of the software as well. It's about representation of your city. So the best engineers are still, you still need them, the best architects. But if you look at the role of architects, the architects, in particular the iconic architects, star-making architects, actually they create their own brand. They're part of a new transnational and globalized firm, and this becomes particular visible when we are looking, when we are discussing the new waterfront redevelopment in port cities. Well, so people have talents and they promote the talents. That's part of marketing. You market yourself. It's part of your promotion. You're self-assured. Self-assurance is key because that means that you bringing people from all talented people from all those places. This is this positive way, this positive narrative of globalization. Globalization, which brings forward the best talents of the world, bringing together, crossing the borders, bringing all these talents together in new places. So the diversity is part of a very positive agenda here as well. It's a common good. Well, it's a business which can only flourish when there is enough openness. So that means that has consequences for how we are dealing with the public space, the relationship between public spaces and private spaces, which are relevant in this respect as well. So then Richard Florida started with Creative Glass, and he made a great deal of it. So everybody is in the creative sector uses his work, and although his later work has made some adaptations, and Montserrat, she will tell you more about that, about Richard Florida's thinking has developed in time as well. But his original ideas were, of course, related to the creative class is important because creative class creates new wealth in a post-industrial setting. Individuals are central and not the institutions, which of course is one of the aspects dealing with the new liberal way of how we think at the end of history, when institutions were taken over by individual talents. So the individual is crucial. Individuals should use all his talents in order to create these new added values. And these individuals, where do they want to live? They want to live in cities which have the capacity to become creative places in itself. Just follow the creativity. That's why, for instance, soft city is an important aspect, meaning embracing a nice, tolerant, open political climate, green, spacious, and a lively cultural scene. So that means that his thinking of the creative class went hand in hand with new ways of how are we going to turn cities into creative places. But, and this is important, it's almost a comparison between, you could say, Flaubert's novel Vigours, create a narrative. And new, we have created a new narrative of creativity. Creativity as an answer to the major challenges we're facing in the world. And it's spread all over the world. It's almost a new religion, from Australia to Africa, from Europe to China. However, and we come to that, we all come up with range of correlations. But is there a causal relation? What is really the added value? Do we have enough empirical data in order to test the hypothesis that that the creative class will create new features for the economy? Well, anyway, whatever you look is the creative economy, it's embraced worldwide. So you could say it's almost a successful global marketing, because the creative economy is a concept which is spread out everywhere, and the creative economy is use new symbols in order to express new ideas. That's why the marketing is so important, of representing the ideas on the creativity. And the creative industries are at the crossroads of the arts, culture, business, and technology, and that makes them interesting. So if you look at the major firms operating in these fields, they actually, what they do, they use all kind of different interdisciplinary fields. And well, in the end, you could say, what is then the role of creativity? What is the aesthetic, creative part? Well, perhaps that becomes less important over the years. So the creative industries, and normally we have these, they are concentrated in the heritage part, my part. So as a director of the City Museum of Rotterdam, means that I'm, well, this is part of traditional cultural expressions, cultural sites, heritage, arts, visual arts, performing arts, the media, very important, audiovisuals, etc. And of course, the creative services, creative R&D. And I think this is very important, because creative R&D is actually a new way of, it's not about just by engineering, but who is the smartest, has the smartest tool in order to promote your product, and so on. But why are we all doing this? Why are you sitting there? Why did you enroll in these classes of creative, class of global? Because there is somewhere, there's a promising, there's something in the edge on the horizon. There's a big, you could say, well, bag of money. We do it because we want to make money. So we have tried exploring the creativity and the cash potential. And this is what I took from the internet very much. How are you going to trigger them? Well, make sure that there is a relationship between the creativity and the cash. So that means that the city, because of this creativity, that means that there is a return to the city, which started in the 1980s. Cities are becoming since then more important, because they are the places where all these new energies come together. And that means that we all are looking at ways, okay, what does it mean in order to promote our cities? And in particular, what are you going to do when you are a port city, which, well, if you don't have much knowledge about the reason and the role and the meaning of port cities, this is something where you could say, well, the port city is something of the past. It's the old Kondratiev cycle, the end of the 19th century. And then we have the heritage part. We have the Beatles. Well, Beatles, my generation, it's almost nostalgia. And if we are expressing creativity, look at how we are dealing now with urban branding in this respect. The Morpho City, Ecstasy. Well, Ecstasy, you could say, well, Ecstasy has some connotations which are not always looked upon, but there are always different way cities of culture, but also the edgy cities. The port cities are looked upon as edgy cities, cities on the edge, makes them attractive. In the 1970s, 1980s, there were places you shouldn't go to, but because of the regeneration, edgy becomes a narrative of, hey man, that's where you want to be. It's urban, global city shrinking, etc. And therefore, we need to explore that's what McDonald says in his book, The City as Laboratory of Shadows. What are the shadows in the city? So what is hidden behind the city? What are the potentials for the city? And once you see this potential, how can you use them in order to make them more attractive, to turn them into the creative spaces we're all we want them to develop? So arts and culture have become pillars of the new economy. And you can say it's a counterpoint, it's a counter narrative against this typical Fordist expansion of industrial society in the 20th century. Frederick Winslow Taylor with his scientific management. It's about engineering, control, all our organizations which are top down. It's the era of the multinational companies based on very strict divisions, almost organized like an army, in control, different layer of managements, and very much output orientated, not creative orientated. Well, the cultural production then is invented as a model of, well, modern production process, flexible, decentralized, independent, and production units. The consequence, of course, of when you divide the assembly line and you cut them and take all the pieces and you spread them out, distributed all over the world, you create a transport. But because of the lower transport costs, it's quite easy. Transport was not a problem. Perhaps it's going to change because of the climate crisis and the crisis we're now in. So, and that's already in Verhetzel and Sell, what Sassen came up to, advanced service economy, are driven by a specific category of creative knowledge workers. These are not the guys on the docks. These are not the casual laborers. These are not, these are the talented people who cross borders, part of a new international, transnational community. Actually, you are part of this category. And the quality of place then is directly linked to urban development, the role of creative class. So in order to enhance the quality of places need to be reinvented. And in order to do so, you have to make sure that there is a new role of the creative class, which has a spatial consequence as well. Because creativity results in a new way of urban planning. Soft city is an example. You need to plan to organize the soft city. It's a different planning, etc. So it has urban consequence as well. And then, well, what about the evidence? And Lily Kong, it's not on your reading list, but it's a great paper, because she actually said, okay, Charles Landry, Richard Florida, they spread the word, but how are you going to convince the non-believers? Because their handbook has some aspects. Okay, says she, well, perhaps we have to do more empirical research and tests how it works. And interesting that, and I quote from a paper, if the creative economy strategies cannot be replicated in the UK, why should countries with a completely different culture be considered suitable for the same strategy? End of quote. And of course, we as cultural and social historians know that culture is vital. And cultural differences are very, very important in order to understand the local reactions to global processes. So they're very skeptical, because the model of Richard Florida is based on American identity, an American way, as the idea of the 19th century and idea of empire was based on typical westernized idea. So she came up with different aspects for which are relevant to test the hypothesis. The fact is that, do they create urban benefits? Okay, how can you show them? And for instance, all these Starbucks areas, which are part of a creative neighborhoods. But who gets the dividend from Starbucks? Local people? Something which is relevant when we discuss the waterfront regeneration and the regeneration of districts, and what does it mean for the people? It's important that this economy is not state but market driven, which is of course part of the globalization process as well. This is something with the market. The market is driven. So the wealth creation, but it creates a lot kind of service jobs. But what kind of service jobs are created? A lot of self-employed people in the cultural sector, for instance. Look at the crisis at this very moment. Who is unemployed at this very moment? These are the self-employed people working in all these creative industries who cannot afford a decent house, etc. They live on the margins. Well, the face, and this is important, it's iconic building. The wow factor has become very important. And this is an aspect which is so dominant when you look at the new waterfronts. And this is something I'll come to in my other lecture. And the role, of course, of transnational capital. If you look at who are the winners and losers, again, of globalization, you would say there's a flow of transnational capital, foreign direct investments. But who gets the benefits? Who gets the rates of return? And this has to do, of course, with this transnational mobility of people. Nobody objects against a transnational elite bringing in new money, new talents. Look how everybody chases after Brexit. Everybody wants the most talented, gifted people from London, bringing them to the continent. These are welcome. This is a different category. So global, the successes of global creative capitalism has to do with this transnational mobility and the consequences. So, and the idea is that people are creative, they are cosmopolitan, meaning that people, it's very easy, you go there where the jobs comes, and crossing border is very easy. Well, it's not. Look at cities which are based on evidence on creative class, it's mobility in Europe. Well, you can say that there are large differences. Some cities are really quite cosmopolitan, have an open mind. A city like Amsterdam, for instance, if you look at the creative class, is one of the major cities. Helsinki is another example. But these are cities in small countries which are used of open their window. So to them, it's quite natural to bring in the talents. But if you want to become a museum director from the Netherlands, for instance, in Italy, well, that's not easy. It's one of the, I haven't told you, but I'm quite fond of Italy. So but it's not easy to move in the cultural sector. So the open, even the creative class, if you ask people, why do you move to another place? It's because most of them are very honest, say, well, if I had the option, I would stay near my home, near my family, but I take the opportunity. So this is something which is not always clear to discuss what are the reasons. Well, what are the conclusions on mobility? Well, Amsterdam, Toulouse, and Munich are the most open cities. Least open cities, Barcelona, Milan, and Poznan. Semi-mobile, Helsinki, Budapest, Leipzig, and Riga. So creative mobility, that's their conclusion, depends less on the size, location, and history places, but on the relative weight of the creative industries in the cities and the connection to the global economy. So once you have a creative district with a lot of potential, then it works as a magnet. And if you don't have such a magnet, which is, for instance, the case in Amsterdam, which is a large cultural sector, international sector, large creative influence, firms in advertising, public relations, worldwide firms, then you have a cluster. And the clusters, thinking in clusters, is not something new. The diamond of Porter was based on the fact that linkages between networks in geography are related on clustering aspect where you're very good in. And this is interesting in order to draw conclusions about the future developments. Because once you have a very strong sector clustered in a traditional economy, for instance, the port city, how are you going to turn that in a creative cluster? That's a huge challenge, I can tell you from my own experience. But the relevance of port cities, and these are the three slides I want to conclude this part, is what is relevant port cities? Well, of course, there is the cultural heritage part. What are you going to do with all these derelict areas? Imagine when Rotterdam floats on oil. What will happen in 2050, 2060, the new Kondratiev, when, well, we don't consume oil? What are you going to do with this huge industrial petroleum scape? Are you going to turn it into a heritage park, like a kind of Jurassic Park, where you show how people used to live in an age of oil and automobiles? I'm not sure, but heritage is a concept which works in that area when there's a close relationship between the port and the city, but once there's divided, as in the Rotterdam case, it becomes more difficult. All kind of aspects we have to do. Well, the major question is then, how are you going to create new future for all the ports? Economic value is returned to the city region. This is what you want. And there are all kind of, you could say, the ideal worlds in industrial port and the post-industrial port. Heck, cultural heritage turned to exclusive tourist commodity. So part of the tourist industries. So you can say the sailor from the past has become a tourist, because what is the, if you compare them, a tourist is someone who stays in a city of a place for a particular time period. And while he's there, he's going to enjoy himself. Well, what did a sailor do when he is on the job, he's on the docks, he's off the docks, going to town, he's going to the pleasure scapes, where the fun, where the pleasure is. So he's entertaining. So pleasure scapes as a tourist industry, as an industry developed because of the fact that the port cities, because there's so many sailors coming into the port. And now the tourist industry, which is brought in with ships, these cruise vessels, but is that sustainable? Look at the examples of Venice, for instance. And the people from Venice are not that enthusiastic about these cruise ships. So perhaps there's a turning point that is this for the long term sustainable. If you look at the people working on the waterfront, the new migrants selling these bags, I'd already told you about that, then it's not the sustainable economy you want. So if we, and then I move to the other parts, if you want to innovate in port cities, in the creative sectors, then you have to discuss what are the relevant values. These soft values are very important in order to understand what's going on there and what kind of strategies you have to develop in order to turn them into creative. And perhaps we have to conclude what's now happening on the waterfront, that port cities aren't that successful. But that makes them even more interesting.